This is the week of Thanksgiving. Always look forward to that. What a wonderful time of year. Later this year, so it goes right into the Christmas season. But this song we just sang, it reminds us that we should be continually pouring out our hearts, expressing gratitude and praise to God for the blessings in our lives. Sometimes we fail to see those answers to prayers right away. We don't see them till later. But God never fails. He always answers them. Our Jesus is holy, mighty, always worthy of our praise. 2 Samuel 22:4 says, I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise. And this next song, it's kind of repetitive, there's echoes, But it tells us we need to follow his teachings, take time to listen to him, and love him all the days of our lives. It's a reminder of our relationship with the Lord and our true purpose in life. Jesus gave his life to save ours, so why can't we live our lives for him? Psalms 136:3 says, "Give thanks to the Lord of Lords." So please stand with us as we sing, "You Are Holy, Prince of Peace." You can sing either part you feel comfortable singing.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
Nice when the church gathers as the family that we are. So I'm so thankful for you all coming out here this morning and participating with us as we gather our voices together and praise God for the things he's done. I know that I look forward to Thanksgiving time. I usually do nothing during Thanksgiving time other than eat. And that is my responsibility, and it probably will be again this Thanksgiving, so I'll be thankful for that. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you and we do love you. And Lord, when we just sang that song that says that we live our lives for you, Lord, I know that in many ways I fall short of that. So Lord, I just pray that as we gather together to worship you, Lord, that your spirit would energize us, not only energize us, but cause us to think about how we do live for you and not just merely service in the church, Lord, which pastors are often doing in order to try to get people to do the work they think they need to do. But Lord, as we go out of this place, as we drive our cars, as we work in the field, as we meet people at the the mall or the grocery stores, Lord, may we live our lives in a way that express that we know who you are and we have a relationship with you. And Lord, that includes me and some of the posts that I even make on Facebook that I realize afterwards that isn't exemplary of what a Christian ought to be, Lord. So I just pray that these words that have been sang, the words that we will look at this morning, the attitude that we're supposed to have as we go into the season of being those people who are extremely thankful, to think about all the things that you have done for us, all the reasons that we have to be thankful for, no matter what we're going through, Lord, at the end of the day, when we stand in your presence, the ultimate thanks will come to you for what you've done on our behalf. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning once again. We have a few announcements this morning. Firstly, there is a Thanksgiving service tonight at 5:30 at Fellowship Baptist Church on Mount Carmel Road. It's up 67 here, a few miles. All are invited. It's not technically a community Thanksgiving service, but they are inviting the community. So, Women's Black Friday dinner out at Chef Lynn and Frederick at 5 p.m. That is coming up on Black Friday, right? That's coming Friday. You can sign up. Where's the sign up for that? It's in the vestibule for the sign up so that they know that you're coming up. There's apparently a few sign ups in there. I'll get to some of those other ones. The Summerford Home, we've been going there every third Sunday, right? Third Sunday, sharing in music and message and just trying to minister to the people that are in that home. We find ourselves looking to collect some fluffy socks. Warm socks. So as you're going about and doing your Christmas shopping and any other shopping that you might be doing, if you happen to see some of these and feel like bringing some in to donate so that we can give them to the people that live in Summerford, that would be an additional thing that we're trying to do this December for them. Also, the women's Christmas dinner party is on a Sunday this year. It's on December 8th at the home of Margaret Moore. You can let her know that you are coming by also signing up in the vestibule. That's another one of those sign-ups out there. And then also every December to support our Light of Moon Christmas offering is for International Mission. We provide a service of distributing your Christmas cards within the church. So we usually have a table set out there, and you'll see a stack of Christmas cards as people fill them out and whatnot. The reason that we do that is that in exchange for we kind of do the delivery of the, since we're here every week, it makes sense. We submit the Christmas cards here that you would do. However, in exchange, we ask that you, however many Christmas cards you would have mailed, you just take that postage that you would have spent and donate that to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, if I said that coherently. Let's see, I went off script here. You are not limited to that amount on the postage. You can donate more if you'd like. But the card drop-off will begin next Sunday, and that is through December 22nd. So we can at least pick up a new card and address list in the vestibule. That is also in the vestibule. Everything's out there this week. So all that being said, Brother Mark.
Good morning. Today's reading is from Psalms 100, verses 1 through 5. Please stand if you're able for the reading of God's word. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter the gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Please remain standing as we continue in song.
Our next song that we're going to sing together is Who You Say I Am. The first line of the song says, "Who am I that the highest King would welcome me?" It reflects the depth of love that God has for each one of us, his affection for us. It's a beautiful message communicating the effects of salvation, transitioning from a place of darkness and bondage to light and freedom in Christ. But it came at a huge cost. Jesus had to die. This song glorifies God as he defines who I am, who you are. Please join us. Verses 9 through 11 says, "Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Please join us in your great name.
Thank you.
Some of you may have picked it up. I don't know whether you have or not, but Sandy saved me a little embarrassment just a few moments ago. She immediately picked up that I was planning on walking up here on the first song, at the end of the first song, instead of the second song. So thank you very much there, Sandy, for doing that for me. If you have your Bibles, if you turn with me to Matthew chapter 10, we will be there in just a few moments, and we'll start in verse 26. But I just want to read something that I found just recently, and it's Charles Sawyer. He's a former U.S. Secretary of Commerce under the Truman administration. And he tells about a plane that are full of people that are flying across the Atlantic Ocean when silence is broken as a voice comes across the intercom. It says, "We are now flying at 35,000 feet, and if you will look out the right window, you will see engine number 2 and engine number 3, I'm sorry, engine number 3 and engine number 4 on fire. And if you will look out to the left side, you will see engine number 1 and engine number 2 are not running. And I want to give you a notice. I want you to peer out the window, look almost directly underneath the airplane. You will find a yellow recovery craft with 6 small dots in it." He said the dots are the pilot, the co-pilot, the flight engineer, the navigator, and 2 hostesses. This is a recording. So you kind of get it, what's going on there, and I don't know why he does this. During the Truman administration, he's probably bringing something out about how we respond to fear. And I could imagine if you had that going through the intercom, you would be terrified to know that all your engines are out, and then all of a sudden find out that it's a recording and that everybody that could possibly help you is gone. I mean, that would be a frightful thing. So what I want to do this morning is I want to do what Jesus actually does in this passage, is he kind of addresses the fear of the people, and out of addressing the fear of the people, he gives us, or what we can extrapolate, he gives us 3 reasons that we can be thankful to God. And one of the things, if I do not do it, you know, I believe that God has impressed upon me to go back to Psalm 100 as what Mark has read so that we can pick up a couple of key words there so I can explain to you why I've tied that passage into the passage we've had this morning. Now, fear, we know that in large doses, fear can be bad for us. I think we all know that. It causes deep anxiety. It causes our immune system to be compromised because it overtaxes it with adrenaline flowing. It causes depression. It impairs our decision-making process. We don't know how to actually respond to things. It increases cardiovascular disease and heart attacks and all kinds of other things. It creates headaches. If you've got so much fear going on in your life, it creates muscle tension and neck tension. It also causes all kinds of digestive issues. And I believe that this is the reason why Paul told Timothy in the book of Timothy to take a little wine for your stomach, as he is appointing elders all over the place in these brand new churches with people that barely understand any theology. I can imagine that young Timothy is having quite a go at it. But fear, in the proper doses, is good for you. It evokes the flight or fight response, and it removes us from danger. We get in our heads, this isn't a good place to be, and we get out of there. In moderate doses, it can actually help our immunity by exercising it, kind of like physical exercise. It will make us more cautious, causing us to be keen in our decision-making process, whereas too much fear causes us to be paralyzed. In a nutshell, healthy fear does a good thing for us. And so even though that I've talked about fear this morning, I'm going to transition from that fear over to thankfulness as we look to the words of Jesus. And what I want you to do as we go through here, and if you're the person that highlights in your Bible or underlines in your Bible, I do. We're going to look at 3 places where Jesus tells us not to fear in this passage. And as we get to it, just underline that, because every time I go through the Bible and I see something like that, it reminds me that Jesus is talking to us. So let's start in verse 26. It says, "So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in dark, say in the light. And what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them fall to the ground apart from your Father? But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore you are more valuable than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. If you first read over that in a cursory glance, you might think to yourself that this is kind of a little bit hard to understand, but it's really not. And that's why I think it's important to have your Bible open in order to understand the larger part of this. And if you look at the larger part of this and back up to the next section, Jesus is telling them why not to fear. Because he's talking about the persecution that's going to happen to the church. He tells us all these things, and then he tells us three times not to fear. And if you look at verse 26, it says, have no fear. That's something that shouldn't be part of it. Verse 28, do not fear. Don't go into that area. In verse 31, it says, fear not. Now, how many of you have been taught that when you read the Bible, if you see something repeated, that's a literary device used in order to emphasize something? If it's repeated, it's an emphasis on what you need to pay attention to. Now, there's only a few places that the Bible reiterates something three times. And you know where I'm probably going with this. The most important example or illustration of God repeating himself goes back to Isaiah chapter 6, where we see the seraphim calling out to God, holy, holy, holy. Isaiah's writing is telling us that we need to be aware that God is holy, and when he comes in contact with a holy God, what happens? He becomes a basket case. Here Jesus is telling us that when we go through intense persecution, to do what? Don't fear. Don't fear. Don't fear. And this is where I'm going to take you back to Psalm 100. And I want you to go back here because it's really kind of neat. We're coming into the Thanksgiving service. And I use these passages, and this morning I use this passage concentrating on Thanksgiving, also connecting it to what Jesus said. And I'm thinking to myself, they're not going to get it. They're not going to get it. And it's not that you guys shouldn't get it, but I'm just thinking that they're not going to get it. But I'm going to tell you why I use this particular passage. Now, we only have five verses in here, and it really comes down to verse 5. For the Lord is good. How often is he good? Always. And then the next part it says, his steadfast love endures for how long? Forever. This is why I go to this passage, because this word steadfast is the word hesed, which is a covenant term that God uses to describe his active love towards his people. Now that right there ought to be a Thanksgiving passage right there all by itself. We give thanks to God because he's got a covenant love towards his people that cannot be moved. And so when I go back to this particular passage, Jesus is showing us how much God loves us. Do not fear. Do not fear. Do not fear. He loves you. No matter what persecution comes to you, I've got you. I'm not going to leave you. My everlasting or steadfast love endures for all of eternity. So that's where we come to. So I'm going to give you three reasons not to fear. And then I'm going to give you three reasons that we're going to extrapolate from the reasons not to fear in order to give thanks. You get it? Three reasons why we shouldn't fear, and then three reasons why we ought to be thankful. And we're going to extrapolate that from the three reasons not to fear. So the first reason he tells us not to fear is found in verse 26. And he tells us all those wicked and all those evil deeds and all those things that people do to us, when it comes to the day of judgment, all those things are going to be found out. Everything that people do behind the closed doors, everything that they say, everything that they try to do will one day be shouted from the rooftops. Nothing escapes God's vision. Nothing escapes God's thoughts. God will hold them completely accountable. In verse 26, Jesus begins to comfort those he had just told in verses 16 to 27, persecution's coming, but fear not, they're not going to get away with it. Not going to get away with it. Or God ain't going to let people do things to his children and them simply to be able to walk away from it. And I know what it feels like to have somebody behind you and nipping at you and nobody else can see it. I mean, I know what it feels like. I've had it happen to me numerous times. And you don't want to bring it to light. You don't want to look as though that you're, you know, trying to belittle somebody, because they're not going to believe you anyhow. But God's watching those things. He sees it. He's going to straighten it out one day. The second reason Jesus tells us not to fear is because God is greater than anything that anybody could ever do to us at any time. Always greater, always bigger, always better, always more powerful. There's nothing stronger. There's no one stronger than our God. And it's kind of like having a superhero. I mean, you know, I don't want to belittle it to that, but it's kind of like having a superhero as a child. I remember when I started going to school and was riding on the school bus, I was one of those kids, you could stick on a train and send me to Timbuktu all by myself and it wouldn't bother me. I didn't care. I mean, I was enjoying life. It was an adventure for me. But when I started in first grade, not going to mention their names, they're still around. I don't want them to bully me now. They bullied me back then. And I had this one guy who would get on the bus, and he was a couple of years older than me, and he would always bully me, and I never understood why. You know, I was just an average kid, as skinny as a rail, but I was just an average kid. And then I had Mark Holmes. And Mark Holmes, I mean, he was in middle school, so he was one of those old dudes. I mean, he was a mountain of a man. And he came in there, and let's just say his name's Billy, because it's not. He straightened Billy out. And Billy didn't do any bullying anymore. Unless Mark didn't happen to be on the bus. But the thing of it is God's not leaving us on there all by ourselves. He's always there. He's greater than, he's better than, he's bigger than. It's kind of like having a superhero all the time with you everywhere that you go. He says, don't fear those people who can hurt you, but we're better off to fear the one who can destroy both body and soul in hell. And the third reason that we're told not to fear is in verse 31 is because God says that we have an inestimable value. We have more value than anything in the entire universe other than God himself. We are the pinnacle of creation. He compares us to the value of a sparrow, which we're going to go into just a little bit. And he says, if God can value this little tiny thing right here, how much more are you worth? He says, I really want you to consider it. And in creation, man is considered the pinnacle of all of his creation. The only thing higher than that, I believe, in all of creation, and this, well, God's outside of creation, but in everything that ever has existed, is the Trinity, is the only thing that has greater value than mankind. And why do I say that? Because God himself, in the form of flesh, named Jesus Christ, died for us. Now, I know that sometimes when you think about Jesus dying for us, you have a tendency to think about Jesus the man going on the cross, suffering for the penalty of our sins and being killed. But I think of it differently than that. I think of it as God loves me so much that God himself died for me. And that really puts things in perspective for me. And then I think about who I actually am. And then I start coming undone. He still did that. when I know who I am, and I don't even know who I am nowhere near as well as he knows who I am, but yet he was still willing to do that. So he tells us in verse 31 to fear not, because we have tremendous value. We're almost priceless. We're not priceless because Jesus paid the ultimate price. And we live in difficult time, and fear seems to be something that comes natural. And if you spend any time looking at the headlines of the newspaper, who here refuses to look at the news? Is there anybody who refuses to look at the news? Look, there's more hands than I thought. I can't help it. I'm a news junkie. But the reason that people don't watch the news is because they don't want to be afraid of all the things that are going on. If you just look at the headlines, and sorry if you're not watching the news, I'm just going to read a couple of the headlines this morning, not to make you afraid, but one of the headlines is World War III anytime now as Putin unleashes nuclear weapons. Musk says AI will take over our jobs. Senators bracing for confirmation battles over unorthodox Trump cabinet picks. Iran president swore in with chance death to America. New supercontinent could wipe out humans. Is it true that we only have 10 years left? I'm talking about climate. And then the Philippine vice president publicly threatens to have the president assassinated. Now, if you look at the headlines, you'd think that we all have a reason to fear because the world's going to end in 10 years. It's going to end ever since I've been in school. It was going to end because of ice age. We got to be getting close to the ice age. I mean, that's got to happen before the world gets enveloped in water. Jesus tells us that don't fear no matter what happens, and he tells us why. And from that, we can extrapolate three reasons why we can be thankful to God. And the first thing is that God cares about things we don't even notice. God cares about things we don't even notice. And Jesus points to the ultimate fate of the sparrow that eventually falls to the ground. When we had the bees feast and the guest speaker were talking, and somehow in one of my conversations, prayer, whatever it was, I made mention that my wife used to have a little plaque. It was hanging over the sink that said, "When I die, bury me in the woods so that my husband can find me." And that kind of actually hurt because it was true. I mean, she was a hunting widow. My bow was in the back of my van, strapped to the backboard. I had an opportunity to stop in Poolsville or wherever in Montgomery County. When do you get out of the tree stand, Jim? Dark. When do you get back to the truck? Long time after dark. How long does it take to drive home from Montgomery County in traffic during that time of day? Long time. I have hundreds, maybe even thousands of hours in the woods. That's not an exaggeration. It's probably pretty accurate. And the reason I bring that up is not one time and all that. I've seen some fascinating things. I've watched squirrels drop out of a tree over 100 foot and slam into another tree and flop over in the creek. Or I'd watch a hawk come down there and grab a squirrel off, fly away, and then you can see the tail between the legs, and it looks like the hawk's got a squirrel tail going through the woods. I've watched deer mate. I've watched bears go through the woods. I've seen coyotes. I've seen everything but tigers. But I ain't never seen a sparrow fall from the sky. I never saw that. Have you ever seen that? Anybody ever watch a sparrow fall from the sky or let loose of his perch on a branch? I ain't never seen that. Jesus is using an illustration saying, God sees things that you don't see. He sees these things in your life, and you need to be thankful that you've got a God who pays so close attention to your life that he sees everything. The second thing, the second reason to be thankful, if God sees the small, if God cares for the smallest matters in your life, I gotta rethink about this. The second reason to be thankful is God cares for the smallest matters in your life. He cares for the things you don't see, but he also cares for the smallest matters. If you ever tried to share a problem with somebody, you're going through something and you share it with them, and then all of a sudden they're like, "Jeez, don't, you shouldn't worry about that." Anybody ever do that to you? You shouldn't worry about that. Why'd you share it to them in the first place? Share it with them in the first place? Because you really wanted to know that whoever you were talking to at the moment, that somebody actually cared about it, and then all of a sudden they're telling you, dismiss it. But God doesn't just care about the things that you don't know about. God cares about the little teeny tiny things in your life. It says that every hair on your head is numbered. That's intimacy. Knowing how many hairs are on your head, saying God looks at the little tiniest things in your life and he cares about it, so you need to be thankful. How many hairs are on the human head? Take a guess. How many hairs? The average, 120,000. That's the average. That's a lot of hair. I mean, most of us had that when we were born. You know, some of us, not so much anymore, but most of us when we were born. I found out something interesting. I didn't even know about this. Blondes have the most amount of hair. They have 150,000 average. And black or brown has roughly 110,000 hairs. And redheads have the least with roughly 90,000 hairs on their head. And I figured that the blonde jokes must have some validity to it because God knows them very well. They have the most amount of hairs on their head. I couldn't resist myself when I saw that particular passage or saw those statistics. I couldn't even count 120,000. I'd be so distracted, but yet God knows us that intimately. What does David say in Psalm 139? I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You knit me in my mother's womb. Every strand of DNA, everything about us, every quirk before we think it, after we think it, he knows all about it. Not only does he know all about it, he cares about it. He cares about things that we don't even know about. I had something happen to me on the New Jersey, not on the New Jersey, I was actually in Pennsylvania. I went from the New Jersey Turnpike to Pennsylvania. This is going to sound like a preacher's illustration or a lie. So you're not going to believe it, but I'm going to tell you anyhow because it's true. I went to New Jersey and picked up some Gravely tractor equipment. All y'all believe that if you've been to my house. I go up there for $50. I drive, I don't know, I think it's like 400 miles up into New Jersey. I grab this Gravely equipment. Has anybody seen my little wooden cart? Neil, you've seen it, right? It's a piece of junk. I've had people call it my potato cart. It hauls, without the wood on it, 1,000 pounds. And Brother Clayton always puts about 2,000 pounds on it, which shouldn't be on there in the first place. I get this old Gravely equipment on there. I'm coming down the Pennsylvania Turnpike. And I'm one of those people, things get my attention, and I seen what looked like a rock kick up off the road behind me out of my driver mirror, and I'm like, well, that's kind of strange. I didn't see no rocks in front of me or anything like that. And then I'm going down the road, and I just, it doesn't feel right. I'm just kind of coasting along, and people were passing me, and so I slow down to 55, and I figure, well, I got 5 miles, I'll pull over to the rest area. 5 miles. I pull over to the rest area. I get out the truck, and I look. There's not a lug on one wheel, and two of the studs are broke off, and the wheel's on there. There's a little groove in the axle where the wheel was riding in the axle. There was a truck driver that was asleep in the parking lot. I knocked on the door, made him come out and take a look at it, because I told him, you ain't never seen nothing like this in your entire life. I wouldn't believe it if it hadn't happened to me. I was so stunned by it, I even had a cell phone. I didn't even take a picture of it. Long story short, this is on a Friday, so I have to find a trailer company opening so I can change the hub of my axle in order to buy a new wheel to fit the new hub so I can put it on there so I can get home. Why do I bring all this up? God cared about the things that I couldn't see. Could you imagine on a Friday on the New Jersey Turnpike what kind of accident would have happened if that wheel had come off? It wouldn't have just been me. God could have had somebody in mind that might already be saved because they did not get killed in that accident that day. That's how amazing God works. Cares about the things we can't see, cares about the tiniest things in our life. And the third reason, Jesus, in verse 29, Jesus contrasts the value of the sparrow against the value of us humans. And we already know it. We're way, way, way more valuable than the tiny little birds. And we get that. But there's kind of something that's veiled or easily overlooked in this passage. And it leads to our third and our final point in our message. God cares for us when troubles come. He cares for us when troubles come. He doesn't back away and just wait to see how we're going to work it out. In our particular passage, Jesus is teaching about our reliance on God who cares beyond belief. This is all built of trials and tribulations and persecutions. He says that the bird will fail, the bird will fall, the bird will die, but God's going to be there. He is going to be there that we can be thankful that no matter what happens in our life, that God's going to be there when bad things do happen to us. You are more valuable than a bird. And how do I know that? Jesus didn't die for birds. He died for people. This is why I keep telling people that good theology has a way of uprighting or upside down ship as we go through life. In this life, due to our small minds, we are going through one mystery after another. We're going to experience so much that doesn't make sense to us in any shape, any form, any kind. And when that happens, you have to toss out your anchor on the one who's never left you, and you have to place it in Jesus Christ. When the Bible says that Jesus is my rock, I believe it. It keeps me from drifting when the waves get really heavy and really big. Good theology has a way of uprighting your upside down life. And I want to close with this. I'm going to ask the deacons to come forward in just a few moments. And actually, that's not true. I'm going to close with this. I'm going to have Talon do us a song of invitation. After that, I'll ask the deacons to come forward. But it reminds me of two individuals who underwent intense persecution, and because of their relationship with God, and because they knew who He was, they were immovable. It's Hugh Latimore and Nicholas Ridley. These were two English Protestants during the 1500s. And I don't know if you know much about English history, but when Mary Tudor took back over England, Mary Tudor was Catholic, and she didn't like Elizabeth, who allowed, Queen Elizabeth, who allowed the Protestants to gain a footing in England. And so Mary Tudor got her nickname as Bloody Mary, and then when she got back into power, she expelled all the Protestants that she could get, and those who happened to be priests, not priests, but pastors, she would execute. And here are two of them. Hugh Latimore and Nicholas Ridley were being executed by Queen Mary by being burnt alive at the stake. And it says, as the wood was being prepared and they'd been lashed to the poles that would seem to secure them in place, and as the flames from the torch set blaze to the wood that would consume their lives, Latimore retained his confidence in God. Why? Because he trusted him. Now I want you to listen to these deep words of assurance as the torch set blaze to the wood that they were set on. Latimore says, "Play the man, Master Ridley. Play the man." I don't necessarily think that's one of the things that I'd be really thinking about once the wood set on fire. "Play the man, Master Ridley. What shall this day light? We shall this day light by God's grace in England, as I trust shall never be put out." And it said that both of them were executed and neither one of them cried out in pain because they trusted God the entire time. Jesus is telling us in this passage that we need to place our trust in him no matter what's going on, because God is an unbelievable God and he loves us with an unbelievable depth. Brother Town, would you come and play us a song of invitation this morning? Do you get shaken when things hit you in life? Who do you take it to? Do you take it to your spouse? Do you take it to your friend? Do you take it to your coworker? All these things, most of us do. But do you often recoil and back away from God when persecution or travesty or illness hit? I know that it happens to a lot of people. I even know some people that when their life gets rough, they actually pull themselves away from church. They feel as though that church doesn't have the solutions for them. It doesn't, but God does, and Christ does. And Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit is best met within the fellowship of the believers, because every believer has the Spirit of God that dwells within them. The Bible says, as iron sharpens iron, it's one of the ways that we uphold one another. This morning, I'm going to ask Brother Town to play us a song of invitation. And if you've never come to Christ for the first time, I pray that you do. God cares for you. He loves you. Jesus died for you. He died in order to forgive your sins so that you would be able to stand eternity with him. Maybe you've been attending for a while and you're like, you know, this is a place that I feel the love of God. I hear the word of God being preached. This is a place that I'd like to belong to, and I would like to express that publicly today. If you would like to come join this church, come forward this morning.
Please stand if you're able.
Lord Jesus, I long to be Lord, at thy crucified feet, by faith for my cleansing, I see thy blood flow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Lord Jesus, thou knowest I patiently wait. Come to those who have sought thee, thou never said no. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
Please be seated. If I can get the deacons to come forward this morning and want to bring.